When we got the so-called freedom, one of the things that the current leadership did, or the leadership of the time did after 1994, was to actually divorce black people with black consciousness. Was to actually kill anything that is black consciousness and pan-Africanist. We even changed the holidays and the calendars. What was Sharpeville Day and Heroes Day became Reconciliation, became Human Rights Day. We became the only country that celebrates human rights twice in a year, mainly because we're killing the history of the people of Sharpeville, mainly because we're killing the history of the people that liberated, that seek to liberate this country. Are you there, young people? I'm talking to you. I'm talking to young people here. Because I want you to go back into that history and bring it back. As long as that history, Andy, is not revived, as long as that history is not told, we are still going to remain landless and we're still going to remain maybe anti-black, anti ourselves. It gets me sick to think of it that we're still arguing at the University of Pretoria the issue of Afrikaans. It gets me sick to think of it that we're still arguing in one's university school about the hair. What kind of hair should we have to get you to that school? It gets me sick that we're still a country that doesn't understand that now we own the means of production, and the first means of production is the land. Where is that leadership? If that spirit is dead, then this country cannot be free. We'll have to, that is why I'm saying, Andy, your first portion, your first part, is the part that says, what is our real history? Before we can even discuss what is our blackness, what is our land? Because we are being deprived our land, because we are being deprived our history. We read more of a history that is colonized. And we support it. And our children get a P, a 39% pass, mistress. Oh, mistress, no, by the way. Oh, mistress. So come on, mistress. One of the old teachers of Orlando East. Okay? And we work with this old lady now. Now, let me take a pause. Andile, I'm challenging this movement. I'm challenging this movement to correct our history first. Actually, that black first, land first, should have history first. Now, I'm not here. I was just talking to one young girl, and I feel honored that she's here. And stand up, my girl. Stand up. That's a daughter of a comrade of mine who died fighting this for this land. Khotso Siyathulo. That's the daughter of Khotso Siyathulo. I worked with her, the mother, and the sisters, when we actually exhumed the body of his father and put it next to Tsietsi Mashinini to make one hero's acre at Avalon. Because there was no acre for 1976. Isn't this interesting? 1976, you know what you guys do? Dance on the date. You go to me. They go up and they do it. You go that way in 1976, yeah? Tell me one Jewish child who will do that during Holocaust, during what you call the thing? Holocaust. Tell me one Jewish child who will do that. I'm challenging you again. Correct your history. Own it. I've always said this and I'm still saying it. Steve Biko must never rest in peace as long as this land is not back to the black people. Steve Mashinini must never rest in peace until this land is back to the people of South Africa, and that's blacks. And Khotso Siyathulo must never rest in peace. The song I started with, I deliberately started with that song. That was one of the songs of 1976. The song that says, Tina Sizwe, Esinyama, Sizolwela, is late. If it's not in your book, scratch that book. He's writing a book. And then, comrades, I'm not here to bring sadness, but I'm here, my talk was going to be more emphasizing that. I was asked by Andile to also speak about the relevance of black consciousness and Steve Biko in the era 1976. And I'm not going to be long because I've got only 10 minutes, and I think 5 minutes of it is gone. Comrades, don't be deceived. If there was no black consciousness movement, there would have never been June 16, 1976. Hide it in whatever way, in your books or anywhere. It was not the struggle of the ANC. It was not the struggle of even the PAC, maybe in a way. I'll tell you how does the PAC come in. It was not the struggle of anyone, but it was the struggle that was led, generated, instigated, and also supported by black consciousness. Even Tambo himself said something after the time. He said, these young people from Soweto, they caught us with our pants down. Sorry, Baba. Am I there? I'm not taking these pants down, eh? Okay, so please, comrades, I'm appealing to you. Go back to your areas and go back to your townships and say the struggle of 1976 sits right in the middle of black consciousness. It is the struggle that said to us, Bantu education is not there to liberate us, but Bantu education was there to oppress us psychologically. So we needed to liberate ourselves in the classroom so that when we go out, we can let fall of apartheid. And we did that. If you want to know what opened the gates, what brought down the gates of Robben Island and opened up Mandela, it is black consciousness, even if he can deny it himself. What brought those so-called cadres across the borders? What opened those borders that today people are moving so freely in? It is black consciousness. And it is the 1970s. What forced even them declared to go and talk and go to Captain Park. It was black consciousness and young people of South Africa. So please, I see young people mostly here. Don't sell that struggle. I've made one confession, and I want to make it on this Migos Day that you're celebrating today. One confession, Andile, and please note it, and note it for any time that you can say it. One thing that we did as the leaders of 1976, we sold you out. When 1994 came, Andy, us, the leaders of 1976, rushed to become BEE. We rushed to become MPs. We rushed. We wanted money for our pockets. We left you without leaders. We left you without anyone to lead you. And that is why you found yourself leaderless in your communities, leaderless even in your campuses. And I'm saying to you on this day, Steve Biko, which you're remembering, my apologies. Please accept our apologies. And I'm speaking on behalf of those living legends of 1976. We did that. We sold you out. Beat us up. And I'm saying, please, as you are taking up this lecture, please, in that space, allow the space to talk about how young people feel about us having sold them. I'm not going to make another confession. That will be for another day. I wanted to speak about, I wanted to touch on the fees must fall struggle, but I'm not going to do it now. But I wanted to say another note that I wanted you to make. Comrades, please do me a favor. Remember that whenever history is told, it is always told from a particular position. Are you there? Take history critically. One of the things that our current leadership has done, it has frustrated debate and interaction. That they've locked. You do as we tell you to do this. When you speak on the other side and say, it is not like that, they'll shred into pieces. Don't allow that in a struggle. Don't allow that. Be those 1970s students who, you know, today, I say this, Andy, when Seth Mazibuko left this country, he became very unpopular with those who were having cigars and whiskeys somewhere. He told them that I can't be sitting here having the cigars and whiskeys when the children of Soweto are dying. That was the spirit of Steve Biko. That was the spirit propelled by black consciousness. That was the spirit that Steve Biko said to us, fight and fight right up to the end. It was not out of a whiskey or out of a cigar that our liberation was going to come from. And we call that, I'm in exile, I'm fighting the struggle. My fellow South Africans, sons and daughters of the soil, beauty and pride of Mother Africa, this is your land, this is your blackness, protect it. I'm repeating, this is your land, this is your blackness, protect it. If I instigated in 1976 the march, here's another march coming your way. I will instigate it. Oh, now we're done about instigator. And I'm going to be the one that will be actually saying, South Africa and Africa won't be free up until our land is free. Let us just talk that simple language. Don't complicate it. Don't even call it means of production. No, capital. Don't talk that language. Just say, I just need my land. That's all. Don't complicate it. Come on, don't. We know that some of the leaders, let us tell you, we know that some of the leaders, even behind bars in Robben Island, they used to have lack of time. I didn't say anything. You didn't hear that from me. You did not hear it from this old man. But they used to have lack of time. When the Sobukwes were locked in one house, small house, somewhere, when there was a special law for Sobukwe, some people had a privileged law. Yeah. Kalise ni kibuwa kama hama. Anazi kuna mubani. It is very funny that that house that even Sobuge was in is a non-city, as our heritage and history is concerned. People don't even talk about it, but they talk about some other house. You know which one? You know which one? They talk about some other house and some other chef. Namazlo chef, ne? Comrades, I pray today, as you are engaging today about this liberation of the mind and never mind of the chains. That is why all the times we heard the chains as our sign. So we felt that now your head will make sure that your hands are free. Free your head first, then your hands will be free. And I've requested. And one of the things that I wanted to say today, thank you, BLF, for assisting the community of Orlando East during the elections. You guys were very, very active. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And please, one of the histories that must not kill as we are talking today is the history of Sofa Sonke Mpanza, James Sofa Sonke Mpanza, and that's the man that gave birth to Orlando East. And that is the Orlando East that became the mother town of Soweto. Soweto is born out of Orlando East. Did you know that? Did you know that you're sitting on history? You're sitting with history around you. And it was good of you to have brought it here. And please, as you are memorizing this, and as you are busy taking your memories, please also speak of that history, of that man. My last one. And I know I'm going to differ with Andy. This one I'm going to differ, and I was ready to differ. Our South Africa, call it Azania, is handled by people with dirty hands. So-called freedom is hankered by people with dirty hands. Some of those hands have raped. Some of those hands have some of those hands are holding the money that is supposed to be your money. Some of those hands have deprived you of that land and took better part of those of that land with many wives. So I am saying that is where I will differ with Andy. I've agreed with him in so many things. And I wanted to make that point. On that one, I know. Let's clean our hands. Let the leaders of this country clean their hands. Let them be ethical. Let them be values driven. Whether they are politicians or they're business people, Andy. And I'm not saying it is only in the business, in the political arena where people are abusing. I'm saying it is also in business. Nowadays, it's even in churches for that matter. Let's clean up our hands. Let's wash our hands so that we can handle this leader, these people are following us with clean hands. So that we can handle this land with clean hands. People died for this freedom. People died so that now, when some of the people of the leaders like Sulma Shamalaki, when he says the tree of liberation shall be watered by the blood of the martyrs, he meant that you guys, you young people, should actually enjoy the fruit of that tree. If you can't enjoy the fruit of the tree, at least enjoy the shade of the tree. And I'm asking you, as long as that land is not owned by blacks, keep on fighting.
Tina Simoni Chosu, who is she? Tina Zipizama, Tina Zipizama, Tina Zipizama.
I
thank you so much, Comrade Buyo, for leading us in a beautiful song. Okay, so there's one thing I forgot to mention when we opened our event for today. I do hope that most of us are on Twitter, ne? And are you following the BLF handle on Twitter?
Yes.
It's at BlackFest, right? Black1ST, BlackFest. Right? Black1ST. So that's our handle. We have a hashtag for today, #BLF Biko Lecture. So
yes.
If you go on your search icon and you search the hashtag, you should see every tweet, everyone that has commented on the lecture so far or leading into the event of today. Ne? So those of us who have Twitter handles, please follow the BLF handle and retweet, right? And retweet as much as you can. And those of us who are not on Twitter but are on Facebook, if you look on your phone, Facebook has their new application now. It's called Live, ne? So you can visualize the event as it happens. And people who are your friends on Facebook who are not here, they can see, hear what we are discussing, what Comrade Convenor is about to say. We also had Comrade Seth Mazibuko live as well on Facebook while he was giving his address, okay? So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to head over to Andile Mngxitama to bless us with his lecture today on how Biko can help us think Black first.
Amanda!
Oetu!
Amanda!
Oetu!
One bullet.
Long live.
Robert Sobukwe, long live.
Long live.
Robert Sobukwe, long live.
Long live.
James Impanza, long live.
Long live.
James Impanza, long live.
Long live.
Brother Baker Johnson, long live.
Long live.
Johnson, long live.
Long live.
Manda.
Wetu.
Ukhona nomama wetu. Uzothetha nangaye namhlanje uHarriet Tubman. I thank you a lot, comrades, for being here, and I'm going to literally read my lecture. Because ngela xesha we were in parliament and politics, we used to talk a lot of nonsense. So I got used to talking a bit of nonsense when I was there. So I want to check my nonsense by going through my notes. The people of Soweto, the people of Orlando East, the cradle of this giant settlement of black people in Southern Africa, Soweto. The people of our occupied country, Azania, I bring you revolutionary greetings from our movement, Black First, Land First. I greet the leadership of our movement, in the name of our father, Stephen Bantu Bonke Biko. I further wish to make a special mention to our brother, Seth Mazibuko, who's here with us. A And the people of Orlando Task Team that we have come to know and work with, particularly around the time of the elections. We do agree with the slogan of the Orlando Task Team that says, one community, one Orlando. One Orlando, one community. We say this slogan must go on and lead us to say, one Azania, one nation. Also, we must thank the elders of this church for opening the doors. And indeed, let us also name and call on James Sopasonke Mpanza, the creator of Soweto, Genkan. James Sopasonke Mpanza built and created this township, Genkan.
Yes.
White people had stolen our land. They were keeping us here at a time in their minds. We had nowhere to stay. Having took our land, the Makaya, forced us to come and work in the mines. Deep gold for them. They don't give us a piece of place to stay. Ubabu James Mpanza said enough. A man on the horse. Wafika lao. Wati, black people stay in these places. And there was a meeting, I'm told, in 1944 or so, Deba. In that meeting, apparently some people who became liberation fighters later on chicken out. Utatu Mpanza said in that meeting, we are going to occupy land. They agreed. When the day of land occupation arrived, they disappeared. So we must not be surprised why today they went to Robben Island, they came back, they did not give us land. Mpanza was giving us land back then. Umtu oti kuwe. Vote for me, I will give you land later, is lying to you.
Yes!
Land must be taken. So we call that name of James Mpanza. Our movement is called Black First, Land First. Because we understand that without land there is no life. Ubabu Mpanza understood that there is no land without a struggle. Yes. He understood this in the revolutionary way of Malcolm X, who teaches us that if your struggle is not about land, it is a struggle that is not worth fighting for. And also Mpanza, as we say, understood that you can't beg for land. Land must be taken.
Yes.
You can't legislate for land. Land must be taken. You can't negotiate for land. Land must be taken. If you wait for politicians to legislate, you're going to remain landless yourself, your children, their children, and also your great-great-children are going to be like all of us landless. Now today I wanted to speak without raising my voice too much. I wish to speak without the rage causing in our bodies. Which is that fireball? Because we are a people who have been wronged for too long as black people. Today, as you remember Steve Biko, I wish for our people to take a step back and think. My appeal is let us take a step back and think. Thinking must not be left to people with university degrees. Thinking must not be left to leaders, politicians, sangomas, priests, and so on. We must all think together as a collective exercise. Then only shall we be free. Now, white people arrived here in 1652. It is well over 350 years ago. They stole our land by force. But they did more than just take our land and make us slaves on our own country. White people also stole our minds. White people also stole our minds. The settler colonizers understood that they could not sustain our oppression with the army only. They were too few. They needed our minds to police us, our minds, so that we don't rebel against their rule. We all know once you defeat the mind, the war is over. Jan van Riebeck and other colonial thugs did not have the numbers. Jan van Riebeck and other, remember all of us at school, I hope we know this. We were here in our country. We were happy people, fighting a little bit occasionally amongst ourselves, but generally happy. We had our land, we had these animals, We went libation with a little bit of the Azanian herb. We generally lived. We generally lived okay. And then white people arrived here. Jan van Riebeek. But the point I'm making is there were few. They did not have the numbers. They could not oppress us, even with their army. They needed our minds. So the first thing they did was to kill those among us who questioned their rule. The next thing was to kill our belief systems, our religions, our cultures. They said our gods were not good enough and made us pray for their gods. They told us, close your eyes and kneel down. A position of total submission. And then, there is a thing in religion that says, Dumela fela, so said you give. Our question, we say no. There must be a reason why the Dumela. Now, but that is black thinking. Anyway, that's what they've done. They've done something else when they arrived here, these people. They made us eat their food. Well, more like they made us eat their leftover food, leftovers. They gave us malamuhodu. They went for the steak. No, don't get me wrong, leaders. I love malamuhodu. But also, I must have the option of the steak. Why is the steak with them and they're not even malamuhodu? So they made us eat their leftovers. They took their chicken and they gave us khokole maotwana. They don't eat that stuff. Now I say it's fine, maybe you love your khokole maotwana, but the drumstick also, we want it. So, you know, in the Western Cape, where there is an ocean, they took the fish and gave us fish bones. We want the fish too. Now, we speak their language. I speak to you in English. They didn't have to learn our languages. And the first people they trusted are those black people who spoke their languages, because they were able to say to them, go and tell these Africans, they must move on this day. If not, we're bringing the thing who's going to force them to leave by force. Then we move. Then this one go and report to the white men. Those Zulus, they say the following. Those of us who speak the white man's language were the first sellouts. Because they were the ones who were telling them what the others are saying. Now, those also who stole our land, the thing that they've done amongst others was to set up a school, a church, and a prison. Generally, they'll have a road also to take the wealth to the new town they've set up. And then there'll be a road that goes to the ocean to take our wealth back to Europe. When they arrived here, they built a school, they built a church, they built prison. Those of you who don't want to follow their rule, of course, they kill. But most of us, we got white thinking through the school, through the church. This is how they brought in white thinking into our heads. The method of forcing blacks to think white follows a general direction, as I say, of a school, of a church. And if you're the kind of black person who refuses the kinder way of civilizing you, by breaking their law, to refuse to accept their right to rule over you, jail waits you. Jail was there to break you so that you conform to their rules. But you know, jail can't keep all of us. So most of us are in schools and in universities. It's an interesting thing when you think about it. If you think about it a little bit, that we fight for free education. But this free education is a white man's education. How did I get that right? Today, let us ask the question, how does Biko help us think black? If they have used this method, killing us, schools, church, jail, to create their white thinking, to put the white man in our heads, how do we then reclaim our capacity to think black? Many black people don't know that thinking is divided essentially into thinking of the oppressed and thinking of the oppressed. For oppression to function, it needs the oppressed to accept the thinking of the oppressor. In big English, they call it assimilation. You assimilate into the oppressor. Your ways are the ways of the oppressor. Dr. Chinwenzu, and I want to, and some of you have heard me speak before, you know this analogy, I love it too much. The analogy of the education of the rat, of the cat, given to the rat. Let me run it. If you've heard it before, be patient with me. Dr. Chinwenzu teaches us that this assimilation by the oppressor, assimilation is this shaping of thoughts and how you see the world. It's best explained by the analogy of the cat, how the cat educates a mouse. Well, we all know a mouse in a natural state instinctively run away when it sees a cat. So in a natural state, that is a natural order. But